All right. Good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is Caroline Kohles. I'm the Senior Director of Health and Wellness at the Marlene Meyerson JCC Manhattan and the Program Coordinator for the Northwell Health Edmund J. Safra Parkinson's Wellness Program here at the JCC. Welcome to Broadway's Best for Parkinson's. Tonight, our topic is when PD enters the relationship. This program is supported by a community grant from the Parkinson's Foundation, and we are honored to have the opportunity to produce the last episode in a series that's been a five-part series, both in person and on Zoom. Welcome to our Zoom Unity out there. Yeah, we're glad you're here. We're glad you're joining us. I want to start by thanking the Parkinson's Foundation for this amazing opportunity. And also thanking our talented guests. You're going to hear from so many of them tonight, and they're really the show. And also for our Zoom audience and our audience here, thank you for coming tonight. Anyone living with Parkinson's can participate in our programs from anywhere, and that's the beauty of Zoom. And those of you that are here in the live audience, there is, Joanne's gonna be walking around. If you have questions, you can write them down. And those in the Zoom Unity, if you want to write them in the chat, we will hopefully get to those. We have a lot to do tonight, so we may not have time. For those of you that love Broadway and singing, we have a great show with performances from five talented singers, including Broadway stars Matt Cassel, Karen Zimba, and Doug Shapiro. Many of our guests are living with PD, including Matt and Broadway musical director David Loud, Rhoda Cahan, and Harold Clement. We will also hear from top-notch medical and health experts, including Gloria Lebeaux, Director of Social Work at the Barry and Florence Friedberg JCC, David Leventhal, Founding Teacher and Program Director for Dance for PD, and Rebecca Gilbert, Chief Scientific Officer of the American Parkinson's Disease Association. Dr. Gilbert, we also got a special surprise, a little after dark surprise. We're gonna be talking about that. So buckle up, folks, because we've got a show. All right. You, again, our audience, are a very vital and important part of this conversation. And please, we want to get your questions answered. Do let us know what you want to hear about. David, I would love for you to come back up. David is a dear friend and somebody I admire greatly. And the warm-up, you guys didn't really get a chance to do this, but I'd like for you to do this again. I'll hold the mic. Because I thought what you said about relationships and Laban was really important and sort of essential for what we're talking about. I believe that every relationship starts with ourselves. And you said that Laban sort of talked about that, right? So
yeah, he sure did. And he talked about these three relationships of relationship to self, relationship to the space around, and relationship to others. Yeah. And I think as dancers and performers, we're constantly thinking about those relationships. Sometimes in theater, we focus a lot on the relationship to ourselves and relationship to others, because that's sort of what the drama is about. But in dance, where we have the added element of adding drama in the space, how we use space, and of course it happens in theater too. So those are some things
and,
that we keep
in mind. And we can think of space, right, as your hand wouldn't be as defined if we didn't think about the space between your fingers, right? So it's a really an important component. Could you show us those three moves that we did so that they get a chance? It was like one where you were pointing and another. I just thought that was great.
Sure. Well, we started with the idea of relationship to self, and we thought about touch, so being aware of our own body. And then we started talking about relationship to the space around us, so reaching in sort of a Bob Fosse style. And then we talked about relationship to others. So the movement that you were talking about was really about finding somebody, waving to them, and calling them into your space.
All right.
And I like to do that as a welcome because, you know, as New Yorkers, sometimes we kind of just walk around like this and pretend that nobody is talking to us or that we're in our own little bubble, and sometimes that's good. We need that for protection. But actually to come into a space together and make eye contact and use gesture to let people know that, hey, we're actually interested in you and we want to have a relationship. We want to talk.
Yeah.
Or we want to move together.
Right. So let's do that for our Zoom Unity, everybody. Let's go ahead and point, right? and wave and bring them on in. Yeah. All right. Beautiful. Thank you. So, David, that was terrific. And Richard, you're at the piano. I understand you have a CD that just came out. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Yes, I can. It's thank you for asking. And it's a CD I made with a fantastic saxophone player, Matt Parker, and it's called Parker Plays X, Parker being Matt Parker, X being my middle name, my middle initial, and it's available everywhere.
Including, I think, don't we have some here tonight?
By everywhere, I mean in this room and in other rooms in the world. Yes, indeed. Thank you.
All right. And we may have Richard come back and play a little bit more for us as we go. But right now, what we're going to do is bring up our guest. Gloria Lebeaux is a licensed clinical social worker at the Friedberg JCC. David's going to join us as well. And Harold. Right. Harold, welcome to Broadway's Best.
Thank you.
You just want to hold it up here and say thank you.
Thank you.
Harold, when we met recently, you told me that when your husband was alive, your world was really each other, right? And then when he passed away from cancer, you suddenly found yourself alone. You mentioned that when your neurologist suggested that you try dance for PD, you had no idea a whole new world would open up to you. Please tell me, what is it like as a single man living with PD to be part of the Dance for PD community?
Let me start from the beginning. I was thinking about this whole issue after we spoke earlier this week, because really I started my Parkinson's journey with my partner. So it wasn't really alone in the beginning. It was with him, and he was encouraging me, and he was encouraging me to exercise and to walk, and to get around, and not to give up. It was a great help. But after his death, it's true, I was alone, because we were basically a very insular kind of twosome. We didn't really let the outside world in that much. That was my whole world, Howard. So when he passed on, I was on my own. And I tried different things in order to get myself going again. My neurologist kept then saying, well, you just need to exercise a lot. Go out and do exercise, but I don't go to gyms. I mean, I really don't want to sit in the gym, do exercise machines. It was not my kind of world I wanted to have. And so she recommended dance for PD. And my first excursion out there, I met David, and I was sold. He sold me on the whole thing. It's been a really great journey for me. It's been, it's a great way to get exercise, great way to socialize with a wonderful group of people. Dance for PD has been a real boon to me, and it's really helped me to keep going and hopefully slow down the progression, which my neurologists have told me that ever since I started, my symptoms have lessened. I was able to decrease my medication, so it's been a great boon to me.
Wow, that's great news, right? To feel that exercise or movement that you love might actually be able to decrease the medication. And David, this idea of isolation and people living on their own and then joining a community. Can you talk about that? Do you find that you have both people that are couples that are living with Parkinson's and also people that are on their own that are part of the community?
Yeah, absolutely, Caroline. And you know, the amazing thing is that we really try to provide an environment for everybody to feel a sense of belonging. And that is what our original visionary, Ole Westheimer, who in 2001 was running a support group for people living with Parkinson's. She had this vision for a dance class, not so much geared towards the motor aspects, which we've come to find are incredibly valuable and beneficial and backed by research, but that it would be a social experience, that for millennia, humans have come together through music and dance. That has been the social glue for us. We've danced through rituals, we dance to heal, we dance to communicate, and music is a big part of that. And so her vision really was that a dance class would provide that sense of belonging for anyone in the Parkinson's community, and that included spouses, partners, care partners, friends, family, and also people who may be living alone. For some of our participants, they say this is the one time in the week where they actually have meaningful, positive social interactions, and the rest of the time they are alone in their apartment. So it makes a big difference.
I'm wondering from our audience, is there anybody here that's tried Dance for PD? Can you raise your hands? All right, and is there anyone that it's new for? Yeah, awesome. Well, great. Gloria, this idea of becoming involved or engaged, do you find that the people that you see, that there's kind of a choice that some people tend to isolate and some people tend to go towards community events? And what's the difference psychologically in terms of resilience and how that can affect them and their progression?
So like everyone else, people with PD have personalities. So you're going to have amazing. If I've said anything else of any significance today, that's the one thing I've said. But I think that's really important because I think we have to recognize the fact that people have different styles. Some people are going to, when they are faced with a challenge, are going to withdraw, are going to go inward, and others are going to go outward. And we have to remember not to judge. However, I would say that a community and the support that comes with other people that understand, that can relate, that are not judging, that look like you, makes you feel understood and accepted and allows you to keep managing and go forward as challenges increase.
Speaking of challenges increasing, David, you have two programs, one which is a standing program and one which is a seated and kind of combined standing program. How does, when PD enters the relationship and somebody's progresses, how does that conversation for you go, that you might have to have a conversation with them, or is it a joint conversation when they can no longer be in the standing class?
Oh, it's a great question. And I just wanted to touch on something Gloria said, because one of the things we hear from participants is they love not having to explain anything to anyone in the room. Everyone there understands what's going on, and it's just part of the wallpaper, and it's fine. Everyone's accepted in that way. So I think that's a big relief, because elsewhere in society, I think people find they have to explain why am I walking this way? Why do I have a tremor? And that gets tiring after a while. So we don't track people from our end. People make the choice on their own which class they want to go to. So here at the JCC, yes, we do offer an all-standing class, and anyone is welcome to come to that class at any stage, and we will, of course, offer inclusive support to anybody. But people generally self-select, and a lot of people, when we started the PRO program, we thought people would choose one or the other. What ended up happening is people went to both. They did the all-standing class, and then later in the week, they came into the seated-standing hybrid class. So all of the classes are inclusive. It really is. We leave it up to the participants to make the choice for themselves.
I love that. I can't get enough dance. So for me, whether it's standing, seated, or, lying down, I'm dancing. So that makes sense. Yeah, you were going to say something?
I was just going to say that as well, the classes are very flexible. Some people might come to the standing class and realize they can't stand through the whole class. So they can actually sit it out and do the class sitting. So it's not something where it's a hard rule that you have to, because of the standing class, you have to stand the whole class.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. The classes are designed around who's in the room in that moment.
Yeah.
And that is what makes it vital, spontaneous, and I think extremely supportive for people.
And I think that's an important part of living with PD. Gloria, can you talk about that? That we've got to think about this moment and how we are doing in this moment. And maybe we have plans for the day, but they need to change, because maybe this moment, that's not possible. Can you talk a little bit about that?
So I think you're talking about flexibility and adaptability, and I think that's true. But I think even more than that, I think we're talking about trying to stay in the moment as much as possible. You know, the only thing in life that quells anxiety, by the way, the cure for anxiety, if anyone wants to know, is to not go forward, is to stay in the moment, to enjoy the moment, to try to adapt to the moment, and not to then anticipate, because anticipating only gets you into trouble. It really does. You start thinking about all the things that are going to go wrong and all the ways that you're not going to manage. So staying in the moment, but remaining adaptable and flexible, those are the folks that are going to be the most successful.
Awesome. Along those lines, Harold, I'm going to put you on the spot a little bit, because we talked about staying in the moment so much that you mentioned to me that you don't really have a plan for what happens as you progress. And is that, and my parents, by the way, if you're listening, Mom and Dad, you've said the same thing to me as well. It's like, we didn't want to tempt fate, right? So, but don't we need to think about the future in some ways? And how do you feel about that?
Planning for the worst, huh?
Well.
Ooh, planning for the best.
Here, well, make sure that they.
Well, I was about to say, and I said planning for the worst. It could be planning for the best.
Yeah.
Okay. I guess that's my point of view. Planning for somebody to care for me, to take care of me, to not be independent. To me, that's not something to look forward to.
And this is one of the reasons why we don't do it, is we think that that's what it might be. But Gloria, it doesn't necessarily have to be that. Talk about what you mean by planning for the best, because I really do want to dispel that myth that planning for the future might mean that we're planning for the worst.
So I think we can talk about planning for the next act. So what does the next act mean? So we could talk about, I think we all are going to be realistic. There are probably some areas that we have to think about. But again, I think we can decide that the future is going to be dreadful and scary and dependent, which I think is what you're, referring to.
Well, that's the way the question was posed to me. Like, have you made plans for when you can't take care of yourself? What plans do you have?
Fair.
Set
didn't
in
mean
place
to do that.
To care for, to have other people care for you when you lose your independence. That was the fearful part for me.
Okay, and I can understand by that question. So I'm switching the question around just to make it different. So if we switch the question around and don't look at it that way, because if we look at it that way, then it's fear that's guiding us. And every time fear guides us, we are going to make really bad decisions. So if we decide not to look at it that way and either see it as, I'm the one who's going to be in control. At least I'm the one that's going to make whatever choices or decisions I want for my future. So it's a spin, and we can say it's a little contrived, but I think if we look at it that way, it allows us to remain optimistic and positive and less afraid. Because again, once fear guides us, we're immobilized and we can't make good decisions.
David, as a professional dancer, you've had to go through this as well, right? There's been times when you weren't dancing anymore. And there's a certain natural cycle, isn't there, to this, and almost a humility to accepting that there will be a time when things will be different. They don't necessarily have to be worse, but they will be different. Can you talk about that?
Sure. I mean, I think it's an aspect of every dancer's life that this thing that is your passion, that is your identity, at some point is no longer to be available to you in the same way. I mean, I always will identify myself as a dancer, but the way that I'm a dancer now is very different from how I was a dancer before. And I think that's maybe a model for the kind of positive transition that you're talking about, Gloria, where it's, you're always going to be all the things that you carry with you in your life, all the various experiences you've had, all the relationships you've had, all of that meaning is there with you. But the way that you operate in the world will change. It changes as part of the aging process. And I'm reminded of a brief story recounted to me by Dave Iverson, recounting a story from Michael J. Fox, who told him that you have to play the scene you're in. You know, you might look ahead and you kind of know how that play ends, but as an actor, you're in that moment. You have to play that scene, no matter, you know, it might be Romeo and Juliet, and you know it's going to end in tragedy, but in that moment, you think that it's the beginning of this amazing relationship. And I think that kind of adjustment that we see artists making throughout their careers to whatever changes are happening in them is a good model for maintaining a sense of self in the face of some pretty significant transformation.
Thank you so much. And speaking of being in the moment and playing the act, I want to thank you all for your participation and introduce you to, we have a very special treat. It's a pleasure to welcome our partner in co-creating this entire series, David Loud. David is going to read. He is a Broadway musical director, actor, and author of the book Facing the Music, a Broadway memoir. It's also available tonight. And most recently, David wrote the vocal arrangements for the Tony-nominated Broadway show, you guys, New York, New York. And that I think it received the most Tony nominations of any show, so which we're going to talk about later. But you guys, feel free to have a seat, because we're going to get a wonderful opportunity to hear David talk about or read from the book, right? I think I stole your...
You did steal my microphone. I thought I would tell you a story today about the best day of my life. It's chapter 30. Took a while to get there. 2014. I had never been to a gay wedding before attending my own. There had been no dramatic proposal. Nobody knelt. We were driving, and out of nowhere, Pedro asked if I thought we should get married on our property or at some other venue. "Are you proposing to me?" I asked. He nodded. "Well, let's do it at our place," I said. Our 20th anniversary was coming up. We had been through a lot. After my Parkinson's diagnosis, I had been so desperate not to stop working that I never stopped working. I was home less and less. I took our relationship for granted. While I was buried in my own whirl of fear, we grew apart without ever acknowledging that problems were mounting. The terror that I carried around about Parkinson's infected everything. Finally, after the truth came out about my mishandling of our finances, Pedro insisted that we see a couples counselor. "I'm not comfortable with that," I said. "I really don't care," said Pedro. "Well, can we talk about it?" I asked. "No," he said, "this is non-negotiable." I'd never seen him so determined. I agreed to go to counseling. Her office was in the Village. I was filled with apprehension. I'd never been in therapy. Pedro was more experienced. I didn't like the thought of airing our problems to a third party, and I resented Pedro for forcing me to go through this. We sat silently in the tiny waiting area outside her office. The distance between us felt enormous. Joan, the therapist, turned out to be frighteningly good at her job. Zaftig and funny and intuitive, she had a disarming way of asking one of us a simple question, listening to the answer, and then analyzing that answer for the rest of the session, mining it for revelations, letting it lead us to what needed to be examined. After a few sessions, I started to understand how essential it was that we talk about our relationship and how it had changed and how we had changed in the 18 years we had been together. It was harrowing. It was more than just my fear of the disease. I had made serious mistakes. Many things had gone undiscussed over the years. One by one, those carefully suppressed issues appeared in that Greenwich Village office, marching out on cue. I found the process agonizing. We said things to each other that I would never have been able to recover from in previous relationships. But Pedro was different from anybody I had known and worth fighting for, no matter how difficult the struggle. At one session, Joan asked me to characterize Parkinson's. A cunning thief, I said. Everything I care most about is being stolen from me. Not everything, she said, looking at Pedro. And do you see how much it hurts him to hear you say that? She asked me. I saw her point. She asked me how I felt when I couldn't work. Like it's the end of the world, I said. And where does that leave him? She asked. She forced me to confront how I had almost destroyed myself and our relationship when I had secretly allowed my insurance to lapse and then gone off my medication. She asked if I felt worthless. I had to acknowledge how much of my identity was tied up in my work. Without work, who was I? Yes, I had felt worthless, and I had treated Pedro as if he were worthless, too. Eventually, the simple act of talking about the problems, the mistakes we'd made, robbed them of their power over us. We held the wedding ceremony on the lawn of our little house over a warm Labor Day weekend. I was responsible only for the music. I hired a swanky 11-piece society swing band that played tunes from the 30s and 40s. Pedro handled everything else. We put up a big white tent with tables and chairs for 125 friends, family members. People traveled from all around the country, many of whom we hadn't seen in years. They parked on the main road and walked down the long, winding driveway through the forest to our house, arriving in twos and threes, their eyes wide with amazement at the sight of the little house in the clearing, the tent, the orchestra, the flowers. They all seemed radiantly happy to be there. Pedro had planned every detail so thoroughly that he actually enjoyed himself the entire day. It was a table stocked with flavored waters, herbal teas and lemonades, so nobody fainted in the heat. The food was simple and delicious. We had the Rolls Royce of porta potties, a large multi-roomed affair with a generator parked discreetly in a field of ferns. As the only air-conditioned spot on the property, it proved very popular. I put on the suit Pedro had chosen for me to wear and put the ring he had selected for me to give him in my pocket. Cellists played Bach and Saint-Saëns as we walked on the grass with our two best women and four flower girls. We processed slowly around the house to the front lawn where our guests were seated. At one point, Pedro, walking ahead of me, tripped over a tent stake. Cojones, he swore audibly. The Spanish-speaking side of the guests giggled. We stood in front of our friend Kathleen, who had helped us plan what we were going to say. He looked so handsome, standing across from me, glowing with the joy of the day, kind and patient, caustically funny, wise and sweet and honest and strong. The time came for our vows. We'd each prepared a personal statement. They would be followed by identical vows, which Kathleen had typed out for us so we wouldn't mess them up. My love for you is unconditional and absolute, Pedro said as part of his statement. There is no illness or circumstance that could ever diminish that. Then he read the vow. I love you and you are my closest friend. Will you let me share the rest of my life with you? I will, I said. I look at you, Pedro, and I know I'm the luckiest person in the world, I said as part of my statement. You are the family I choose. You are the kind face I want to come home to every night. I looked at the vow. Kathleen had mistakenly typed, I love you, and you are my closet friend. I couldn't pretend I hadn't seen it. Turning to our guests, I said, it says here, I love you, and you are my closet friend, and I am not going to say that. I never imagined that I would get a laugh at my wedding. I waited for the laughter to crest before continuing. I love you and you are my dearest friend. Will you let me share the rest of my life with you? There were many firsts that weekend. Our two families met for the first time, and nothing too alarming happened. The man who built our house brought his young son to the ceremony. It was the first wedding of any kind that the boy had attended. I hope that he remembers it as I will, not as a gay wedding, but as a wedding, a day filled to the brim with love. While we were setting up the tables in the tent, I looked over and saw my parents. They were adjusting one of the tablecloths and discussing the place settings. I watched as my mother showed my father exactly how Pedro wanted the silverware laid out. They were smiling. I caught my sister's eye and nodded discreetly at them. She looked at them, then back at me, her eyes shining. At her wedding, 3 decades before, they had been unable to speak to each other. Seeing them together now, after so much time, wrenched my heart open. The years between then and now stretched like a rope bridge between two cliffs. The small red house we had lived in may have been gone, bulldozed into oblivion, but here we were, the four of us, still standing. The ancient ache was still there, but as I watched them, I felt it dissolving. Years of suppressed hurt gently lifted, cleansed by the pure water of this gathering. Look at the two of them, I thought, fussing over the table settings for their son's wedding to a man, a beautiful man who continued to shake me when I needed shaking. I looked across the lawn at Pedro, and I thought something I never would have predicted. I thanked the universe for giving me Parkinson's. Without the calamity of the disease, I realized we would never have had the honest, painful discussions that had saved our relationship and brought us to this blessed day. Thanks.
Wow. We really are talking about love, aren't we? And I love that you said, like, the gathering and the dissolving of the hurt that you had seen in your parents. It just, the healing that can happen when we gather together, right? So beautiful. Gloria, I wonder if you could come back up. And in speaking of love, I want to introduce you to a couple who, for me, is one of the most loving couples that I know. This is their second marriage, and for each of them, and maybe you can even admit how old you are. You guys, come on up, Rhoda and Sam, and they have a perspective about their relationship and also about being together in love. And David, you can stay or you can sit. Okay, fantastic. So this is Rhoda Cahan, and who is living with PD. And Rhoda, how long have you been living with PD?
8 years.
And her husband, Sam Rudick. And Rhoda has been a longtime participant in the Parkinson's Wellness Program and also Dance for PD. And Rhoda was diagnosed, you said, 8 years ago. And her husband, Sam, who is a dentist by day, and is sharing, they're sharing the second marriage for both of them. And welcome. Welcome to you both.
Thank you.
Let me ask you both a question. How is Parkinson's showing up in your relationship? And also, you just heard David's story about his wedding, right? And a joyful moment. I know you guys have many joyful moments. Anything that comes to mind right away?
Well, how Parkinson's shows up is, I know that I have become much closer with Sam because I depend upon him to help me with certain things. And then he, in return, says, all right, you get to do all the technology and pay the bills. But I know that we're much closer than I would probably otherwise be in this relationship.
And David, you said the same thing, that because of Parkinson's, in a way, you had to fight for your relationship.
It's true. It forced us to go deeper into the relationship, and luckily that made it better. The last thing I would have expected.
Yeah. And Gloria, is that uncommon? That we have to have, that a relationship, actually gets closer, or perhaps maybe changes, when we have authentic conversations about the challenges that we're facing?
Well, I think probably most of the time, if a couple is committed to having an authentic conversation about anything, then we have the chance that they're going to get closer. When they are courageous enough to have an authentic conversation about something as difficult as a challenge like PD, and if they're invested and are willing to put their hearts on the line, which is what David and Pedro did, and you can bet your bottom dollar that you are going to reach success. I think that's what will reach success, that willingness to put your heart out there. Really lay it down, you have a good chance of being successful, I think.
Sam, did you want to say something?
Our relationship was so good since the beginning that Parkinson's had no bearing. And it doesn't to this day, believe it or not. It doesn't affect us. We're not trying to make up any plan or resistance. It's just going as best it can, our relationship, better and better.
And I think also we adapt to what we can do instead of focusing on what we can't do. And I know when I was first diagnosed with Parkinson's, I was told by the physical therapy group that, you know, it's degenerative and we need a baseline so we know how you've deteriorated, basically. And so I said to myself, that's not the way I see it. I'm a healthy, happy person that just happens to have Parkinson's. And I'll deal with it that way and do the things that we can do and not focus on the stuff we can't do. I mean, I'm not really so upset that I don't do figure skating or skiing or whatever. You know, I can live my life without that and substitute something that, you know, is really fun. And an alternative.
Yeah, beautiful. I love that flip of, wait a second, I'm somebody with a progressive disease. Wait a minute, I'm a healthy person that happens to be diagnosed with this. Gloria, can you talk about that?
Well, what I just wanted to say is she used the big three-letter word, which is fun. So the fact that they are able to retain fun in their relationship when PD can easily rob that. But the fact that you guys have fun and have fun together.
Excellent point. Excellent, yeah. Yes.
And continue to have fun and have fun, have retained that willingness and that, I mean, you can see it by looking at you. There's sort of an excitement and I'm trying to think of a good word. Just a light.
Raring to go.
Yeah, a raring to go, a lightness. And that's kind of what it takes because it is so easy to go down the rabbit hole of somber.
Yeah,
you know, I mean, that's just an easy place to go. So you kind of have to work extra hard. And that's true of any relationship, by the way, as time goes on and as we age. Fun sometimes gets hard. But yeah, I heard it in the audience right now. Fun gets hard, right? But we need to retain the fun because that is what keeps a relationship fresh and alive and connected.
The doormen in our building voted us the most romantic couple on Valentine's Day. And you were asking about our age. When we first met, which was on J-Date, I had told Sam, you know, I'm whatever, 60, I think. And after we had gone out for a while, I said, you know, I really better tell him the truth that I'm 5 years older, I'm 65. And he said, no problem, I'm 5 years older than I said, too.
So, I love that.
And asking our age, we're 80 and 85, and yes. Don't look it or act it. I mean, we play tennis, and
we work out 2 hours
a day,
which we end up loving it. It seemed like a terrible situation to have to work at. But we're really very, very glad to do the 2 hours of exercise every day, almost every single day.
Yeah. David Leventhal, I wonder if you could pop back up and just talk about how movement can help us bridge the gap between things that we can't really talk about, you know, that we can move them, and maybe even emotions, and as a way to get in there and talk authentically about, wait a minute, how do am I feeling? Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, I actually talk about it a lot at teacher trainings that I facilitate, because something that happens quite often in our classes is that participants will end up actually crying during class. And I explain it's not that they're upset about something that happened in the class, it's that the experience of moving to music in a group can be an incredible release of feelings that have been pent up. And so that the crying and the release is a couple of things. It is that emotional release. It's also, I think, a vindication of the fact that this is a safe and comfortable space for people to express themselves, that they feel that in this community, they don't have to explain anything. They are understood, they are witnessed, they are appreciated. There's a big hug that's sent out throughout the class, and I think that gives people the space to be authentically emotional however they want to be. And that's, I think that there aren't that many places where people can find that space.
And I think, Gloria, that sort of is true in life. As we get to be more digital, right, we're moving less, and we're expressing ourselves in a way a little bit less. Do you find that the people that you work with, when they are active, when they are participating in exercise programs, it makes a difference?
Oh, yeah. I think that any way where people are, first of all, connected to other people, so I don't think it's really just the exercise. I think you're not unless you're exercising alone, and that's a whole other, and that's good too, by the way, but exercising in a community program with other folks, and so you are connecting to other people, allows you to express yourself, to find joy, to release emotion, and of course with PD, we know it's evidence-based that movement of any kind, forestalls some of the process. So on every level, movement is useful. But again, for people who are resistant to exercise, and there are people. We don't want them to feel, there's a lot of, when people go to doctors and the first thing they say is exercise, and you're going to have some people who are resistant, and we don't want them to feel judged or feel shamed. Criticized or shamed, because that's not the thing that they do. But then there's other things. There's other outlets they need to find. There's art. There's writing. There's talking. There's so many other ways of expressing oneself. Exercise is certainly one of them. It's just not the only one.
Speaking of which, I want to thank everybody for doing this. We're going to have a little music break, right? And we're going to actually have Doug come on up and sing for us. All right? Thank you, guys. Thank you, Rhoda. Thank you, Sam, David, and Gloria. And thank you. So our next guest is the first fabulous singer that you'll hear tonight, Doug Shapiro. He's also a caregiver. His husband has been living with Parkinson's for 8 years, and Doug has an extensive career and has even performed to cheering Broadway houses with a bagel on his head. His most recent gig was creating the voice for characters in the upcoming film Lost on a Mountain in Maine. Doug, let's start with a song.
Don't give up the ship, even though you feel it sinking, and you don't know what to do. Don't give up your dreams, even though you may be thinking they never will come true. Life has its own ideas of how things come about. And if you just hang in there, life is gonna work it out. Help is on the way from places you don't know about today. from friends you may not have met yet. Believe me when I say I know help is on the way. You don't have to know where the path you're on is leading. You just have to walk along, dreaming as you go, asking for the things you're needing. You never can go wrong if you have faith that things are happening as they should, and just believe each step you take is leading you to something good. Help is on the way from places you don't know about today, from friends you may not have met yet. Believe me when I say I know help is on. How you've tried and failed, tomorrow you might turn and find that help is on the way. From places you don't know about today, from friends you may not have met yet. Believe me when I say I know help is on.
Come on in. And Gloria, come on up. So let's talk about this. Help is on the way. You picked that song in particular, Doug. Can you tell us why?
Sure.
Thanks, David.
It's, when we got the Parkinson's diagnosis, my husband was alone. He was in New York. He was going to be turning 50 in 2 days. We had bed bugs, and he was about to get audited. I was in New Hampshire. I was in tech for a show, and I was up there. I couldn't get back, and I went to my friend Kathy to tell her about it, and she said, "Okay, we're getting in the car now, right?" And the way that she stepped up, and made me realize, yeah, and we got in the car, and she drove me back to New York. And I was with my husband on his 50th birthday, and then she left and then she went out for a walk so we could cry in each other's arms. You never know who's gonna be the person that'll show up. Also in the caregivers group that I'm in now, I have friends here that are in it as well, and the support that has been being with them once a month. And my husband chooses another path. He doesn't wanna be in a group, he doesn't wanna be identified. That's why I'm speaking very generally. And takes it at his own pace. And so that's been an important negotiation. But that song is for the people that are helping.
You know, it reminds me that for every person that gets a Parkinson's diagnosis, there's their partner or friends or family that also knows when they first realized that they got they heard the news, and that has impact too. Gloria, can you talk about that? That it's not just, Parkinson's isn't just doesn't affect the person that gets it. There's also, when Parkinson's enters the relationship, it enters the relationship. It affects both people.
Absolutely. You know, Parkinson's affects everyone around them, and I think what's striking about you and your husband, and actually what I think is remarkable, is that you each are carving your own path in how you handle this. And I think that that's beyond admirable, but I also think it's a great model. I don't think it's so cookie cutter. I think that people have to respond to this challenge in their own way, at their own pace, and we're all different people. But I think the fact that you as a care partner are going out to get what you need, the support you need, regardless of how he handles it, is what's really, really important. You know, I think what happens in relationships, and the health of relationship, is when people remain individuals, not when they merge and they both have to be the same. So the fact that you each are kind of, you know, minding your own path, I think is fabulous and a great model of how anyone should be handling, I think, the process.
Oh, he's delicious. He's worth it.
I love that. He is very private, and that isn't uncommon. And when somebody who has a diagnosis decides to tell, or who to tell, or when to tell, or not to tell, that's a very individual decision. And Doug, you seem to be okay with that.
It was a bit of a journey. You know, like the, you know, a theme of my life is like loving at, and you know, trying to. But you know, we like I was doing the Parkinson's walk, and because I jumped in and started raising money, all that stuff. And 1 year we're there, and I'm like, wow, I'm doing this for 5 years. She's like, this is not yours. This is, like, it was a really important moment of realizing that he didn't want to do the walks. Mm-hmm. He didn't want to do things. It was, and so I started raising money for the Entertainment Community Fund instead. That's what he said. So it's at his own pace, and then they're just surprises of when he's, you know, you know, we'll meet Matt Frank, and the important part of when, you know, they shared with us what was going on, and he said, "So we're going, right?" Like, that's when he was ready, but it's got to be his own idea.
Yeah. So this sense of timing, Gloria, even Doug, you mentioned that he prefers to go to his medical appointments by himself and to handle procedures and those kind of things by himself. Gloria, that can be a little tricky, right? Because in our healthcare system, don't we need an advocate? Or how do we manage letting someone be completely independent and do it their own way? But at the same time, depending on what happens in that medical appointment, it also can impact the care partner too. So that seems like a negotiation there. Can you talk about that?
Well, yeah. I mean, I think that if the person is competent and capable and has always managed their own medical appointments, I think that involves a certain amount of respect. I think standing back and allowing them to still function as the way they've functioned is really important, and kind of checking your own anxiety, because I think what we're really talking about is managing our own anxiety about what could be happening, what might be happening, and then of course having enough faith in our partner that they're gonna share difficult news with us. And again, that's a relationship negotiation that we always have to do. You know, that can happen if someone doesn't have Parkinson's. You could have a partner who goes and, you know, doesn't go get their checkups and should be getting their checkups, and you keep pushing them to go and they don't wanna go. And I mean, that's a negotiation that couples have anyways. But I think the reality is that the partner has to check their own anxiety and not push it onto the person who has the diagnosis.
Fair. Doug, thank you for sharing your stories with us. We're going to have you stick around because we're going to bring some dear friends of yours, Broadway performer Matt Castle and his husband, musical director, actor, and arranger Frank Galgano. You're
I
right.
Want to make sure they can sit together.
Yeah. Yeah, I can move over.
No, I'm okay. I'm good. We're going to play musical chairs. We're doing
okay.
A little musical
there.
Chairs.
You go there. And then you come here. Gosh, I sounded a little bossy there. Here.
I like it.
You like it? All right.
There we go.
So welcome, Matt and Frank.
Thank you.
Yes. Matt,
that's
when
how we roll in unison.
Matt, when you were here last month on our Broadway's Best for Parkinson's, we learned that you're just 2 years into your diagnosis. Can you tell us when you realized you had PD?
Yeah, and that happens now. It is connected to performing tonight for me. during...
Do you need water?
No, I think I got it. During the spring and summer of 2020, we're theater people, so we were unemployed. We had
more than usual. More than the usual amount.
We're not accustomed to being idle. We're not accustomed to not having a stack of things to do. And the idleness was not good for either of us. And in the summertime, Paper Mill Playhouse called up and said, we want to do a series of outdoor concerts this summer in our courtyard. Would you like to do a solo set? You could have some dates. We'll work it out. Great, I said, let's do that. I signed up for a whole bunch of dates. I signed up to play for somebody else. And when I sat down to start playing, my right hand would not go. I mean, it goes, but it goes slow. It doesn't do like it used to do. I'm used to, I think it and it comes out my hand. And that's not the way my right hand was working. And I was alarmed. This was not a matter of, we've been unemployed for a couple months and I just haven't played. I'm rusty. It wasn't rust. It was something else. And Frank said, then we need to get medical attention for it. I said, I hate that idea. But he prevailed and we had health insurance, so I decided we should use it. And that started a 6-month process that ended up with me getting a diagnosis in December of 2020. 2020, what can I say about 2020?
Don't.
Yeah.
Oh, Frank, do you have any thoughts as somebody who loves someone living with Parkinson's? What is it like for you to watch Matt go through these changes that are no fault of his own?
It's a lot. It's everything. It's every emotion. It's every feeling. Because sometimes, like you said, it's just life. You're just like living your life and Parkinson's is there. And sometimes he can't play the piano. And that's been a thing that he's done since he was a baby child and has made his living doing. And I think you've changed your perspective over the last couple of years, but definitely was a thing that I think piano playing was how you identified. Like you were talking about being a dancer. You're a dancer. You're always a dancer. You're always a piano player. You're always whatever the thing that you love the most. So to watch him sit at this instrument that had been his extension of his voice, and for it to not do the thing that he was used to doing and that you could do that in a way that most people only wish they could do. So it's been sad, but also inspiring, because after a little sad, quiet time, it was like, okay, screw this. What am I gonna do to fulfill myself? You were not 50 when you got your diagnosis, 48. So super early, and we just were having this moment in our career and our life where everything felt like we were on top of the world. So that was 2019, riding high, and then 2020 like had all of the downhill bumps, and I don't.
And that sad time you're talking about was 2021.
That's correct. So it's just been a long period of, I'm glad we had the pause of the pandemic for that to happen, because it gave you some cover and it gave us a moment where we were just alone in our house being sad together or confused. But now it's like, okay, mission moving forward, write, produce, create, keep being like, take every advantage of every moment, because why are we not going to? We were never people who sat around anyway. We travel when we're not working. We jam our lives filled with things and things that inspire and stretch us and make us excited and happy. So why are we going to change that? We'll just do them slightly differently.
David, I wonder if you want to pop up, because he see you nodding your head. This is this idea of a performer and redefining, Gloria, right? Redefining who we are when we're no longer able to do something. David Leventhal. Yeah.
Thanks. I don't have that much to say, but I think it's about you know, what's available to you right now. And that's always what we ask as creative people. I mean, the worst curse to creativity is forcing something, whether you're a writer, whether you're a choreographer, a musician, you know, forcing something to happen. Certainly, we have trained our craft in a way that even on the days where you're feeling kind of tired, or you're not feeling your best, you can still make something happen, whether that's a show, putting a show on, whether you have two shows in one day, how do you get through that second show? That's what technique is for. Yeah, you rest on that and you let it happen. But, you know, there's times when you're actually trying to create something or generate something, you have to ask, what's available to me right now? And sometimes that toolkit, for a variety of reasons, gets changed. And the amazing power of our creative beings as humans is that we are so adaptable. So, you know, we can find different ways to share those gifts, whether it's, you know, finding different roles in the music world, whether it's playing more with one hand, whether it's composing, whether it's, you know, teaching. I mean, there's so many ways to still live within your art and feel fulfilled in your art, but not harp on the thing that is not available.
Thank you. And Gloria, this is really almost, it sounds like the hero's journey, right, in a way. Can you talk about, is this part of that, of becoming one of the greatest challenges of being human is facing these challenges and going through dark periods and then coming out the other side?
I think it's what we all have to do because that's part of humanity, yeah. I think as we age, particularly, we face challenges. If we have an illness, we face challenges. If it's a death of a spouse or a loved one, we face challenges. I mean, these are the challenges in life that we need to find resilience inside of us, and it's an attitude. It's always about an attitude. It's finding that peace inside of us of health and will and strength that wants to keep going and wants to do more and doesn't want to, you know, go down the rabbit hole of, you know, of giving up. And as humans, we're given that. Somewhere inside there is that peace. And, you know, those of us that are, we hope, healthier, find that peace inside and can keep moving. But that is the journey, I think. And I don't even think we have to call it a hero's journey. I think it's the human journey, really. It's what we all, every one of us, no matter what you have, has to find that at some point in our lives, really. You know, that will, that push.
So speaking of that, would you like to play the piano and sing for us?
Yeah, this will be my first time playing piano in a performance setting in 3 years.
Let's do it.
Thank you.
Woo!
If I can't do it here, where can I do it, for goodness sake? I want to say a thing about the song, because when we talked before, you told me you might ask, and though you didn't ask, I've had a thought about this song. The song is Smile, Charlie Chaplin from Modern Times. And the reason I'm doing it, to tell the truth, is I just arranged it for a concert that's going to happen next month. Montclair, June 3rd, come. concert for a string quartet with a baritone singing. And that was the song they wanted, so great. And I cogitated on the song a little bit, and what came out was this kind of bubbly thing. The song is, it's sentimental, and it has a Depression-era pall over it. You know, things are terrible, but don't let it show, just smile. And it kind of sounds like Cover It Up. And I was kind of struggling with the how to relate to the song. And then I thought about something that just came up. Somebody said who you are under, or maybe what I heard was who you are under. I'm not a pianist. I didn't pop out of the womb playing piano. I'm somebody first. And I learned to play the piano. This song makes me think of a story my parents tell when I was little, like 1-2 years old. They'd put me in the top of the shopping cart and push me around the store, and I would wave and say hi to everybody. And then 4 years later, my brother came along. They put him in the top of the shopping cart. I had to sit underneath, and my brother would scowl at people. And that little character study makes me think there's something in there that tells me that's who I am.
Beautiful.
I just wanted to share that.
Well, thank you for sharing with us tonight. I can't wait.
Again, sorry.
Shall we dance? Yeah.
And I know the viola part better than I know the words, so. Smile, though your heart is aching. Smile, even though it's breaking. When there are clouds in the sky, you'll get by. If you smile through your tears and sorrow, smile and maybe tomorrow you'll see the sun come shining through for you. Light up your face with gladness, hide every trace of sadness, although a tear may be ever so near. That's the time you must keep on smiling. Smile, what's the use of crying? You'll see that life is still worthwhile if you just smile.
Thank you.
How do you feel?
Wonderful.
He said wonderful. All right. Oh my gosh. I just need a moment. It's just so beautiful. I got a little lost there, you know, which is what music can do for us, right? David, I'd love to have you come back up. Your husband wasn't able to be with us tonight. Poro. So we recorded a very moving conversation with both of you, which I wanted to share with everybody now. And then we can learn a little bit more about your story.
Sure.
Yeah. So roll tape, please.
Pedro, it's so nice to meet you and finally get to see you in person.
Likewise, I'm so happy to be here. Thank you so much for letting me be a part of this.
Today, we're talking about when Parkinson's enters the relationship. I've heard some people describe it as there's like a third person in the relationship and it's Parkinson. Do you feel that way?
I know that David has said that to me at times. More than a third person, what I feel is that it's introduced trauma into the relationship. Just the diagnosis alone was traumatic, but then each successive challenge has been traumatizing. I recognize that in addition to Parkinson's, we had pandemic. David, as you and your listeners may know, also had to endure very delicate back surgery, open heart surgery. It's kind of like we haven't had a moment to breathe. It's all been very life and death. And it's only been in the last couple of weeks that I've just been able to acknowledge that we're not doing that well. We were very proud of the fact that we survived each successive challenge, that we met each successive challenge. And yet I think they have taken a toll emotionally through trauma that we weren't acknowledging.
Yeah, and I would like to say thank you for naming that. I think your experience is important. I think that there are people in our audience that have experienced successive trauma, whether it's from the pandemic or whether it's from a comorbidity, another challenge, like for David, it was the back surgery and the heart surgery, or whether it's another diagnosis. Sometimes as we age, and just even in life, living in a body, we get multiple challenges at once. And then we had the global challenge of the pandemic. So thank you for saying, hey, it hasn't been easy. We're in that liminal space of, okay, now what? You're both Broadway performers, does music and art and singing and that part of your life, does that help in any way? Do you lean into it to help mitigate the trauma?
Well, that's always been my escape. And the moments that I can lose myself in music, in teaching, in accompanying, in listening, and erase the Parkinson's from my consciousness are the most precious to me. I mean, Pedro's the one who's gotten me through it physically and emotionally, but the music, it's such an essential part of me, and it has been my savior.
With the music that David does turn to in times of emotional distress, he does get lost to a fault, I would say. And that has been some of the conflict that has shown up between us, is that he disappears sometimes so completely that other things just fall off the schedule. For example, David just had a Broadway opening, a beautiful new show called New York, New York, for which he wrote the vocal arrangements, sensational, most nominations of any show of the season. Opening night, we were supposed to meet at the box office. David was supposed to have gotten the tickets that morning. I call David, I'm here, I can't find you, where are you? It's like, oh wait, what? What's happening? I'm like, it's your opening night. I'm at the theater, where are you? Forgot, hadn't showered, hadn't dressed, hadn't picked up the tickets. And this has now happened several times, so.
But did make it in time before the house lights went
down.
I did make it.
Thanks to a crazy cab driver.
I gave you a heart attack.
Gave me several heart attacks.
But I did make it.
But, you know, so I think it's important to have something like music to be able to pour yourself into and to serve as a container for all the stuff that's coming up. And then I think there's a way that it can become dangerous if
because I'd rather be there than here sometimes. Yeah.
It as an escape from reality. And then other stuff starts to fall away in not healthy ways,
it seems
to me.
You know, what is the capacity of the brain to hold on to both those kind of details, which I'm going to say is kind of a left brain function, which is to track, who am I? Where do I live? Where am I going? What's on the shopping list? That kind of thing. And then at the same time, this other part of our brain, which is that creative right brain getting lost in flow and being completely absorbed. How does Parkinson's interact with our brain's ability to do both of those functions? It seems to me like what you're saying, Pedro, is that's the place where there's tension in the relationship. And is that the way it's going to be as it progresses because there's less, you know, reserve in there?
Is there any cognitive impairment that is related to Parkinson's that we should be concerned about? Or is this just an emotional thing that's happening? We don't know. And we don't know how it's going to play out and how it's going to develop. But I'm concerned.
Sure. It may be a bandwidth problem.
Right. Yes.
Meaning that if I have so much bandwidth in my executive functioning, and a lot of that's being used in creating music for the most nominated Tony Award-winning play, then what should we do? Maybe we need an assistant versus, is it cognition? Which it might be, right? We don't know. David, you have said that when is the other shoe going to drop and it's going to be too much for Pedro to handle?
My initial fear, of course, when I was diagnosed was that Pedro would be overwhelmed and not be able to continue in the relationship that we had, which was the exact opposite of what happened. I mean, Pedro very calmly just figured out what he had to do to get me through it and himself through it.
Sometimes not so calmly.
it was amazing. And it didn't surprise me, but it was not something that I had prepared myself for. I think there are times when it gets too much for both of us.
I didn't ask for help because I kept thinking, well, the solution is just around the corner. We just have to get through this and then we'll be back to normal. Okay, now we have to just get through this and we'll be back to normal. So there was always the expectation that this was temporary. I wasn't going to need help. So why bother? You know, we were just going to get to the next thing. And there was always something else. And the second piece of it for me is just as I'm sitting here listening to you speak, what I'm aware of is that I feel shame. I feel that I shouldn't, that it would be a defeat, a personal defeat to ask for help.
Thank you for saying that. I don't think that you're alone. I almost have tears in my eyes. That is the reason, going down into that shame cycle, that is the reason we don't ask for help.
Yeah.
And nothing, and naming it, right, can help us look at that. Because of course, no one can do this alone. And on the other hand, for David, he's going to need to do the same thing in relationship to asking for help, right? When does he need help and when can he do things himself? Because maintaining your independence, David, I'm sure is really important to you.
Of course. And we went through something when I was pretty severely handicapped after the heart operation, where I was relying more and more on physical help from Pedro. You know, could you pick that up? Could you get that for me? Could you bring me that? And I started taking it for granted, and I think overused it, because once we started talking about it, I realized, oh, you know, I really can get that glass, and I could use this, you know, device to pick up that thing on the floor instead of making Pedro bend over and do it.
It was about 6 months afterwards that I finally said, I think you may be more independent than you think you are, but you've just gotten used to this.
I got used to the help.
I said, and just let's experiment. Let's see if there are things that you can do without asking for help. And it turned out that he was, in fact, more independent.
That was a hard thing for me to realize that I had sort of slipped into without thinking about its effect on my husband.
I want to bring up Dr. Rebecca Gilbert, who's the chief scientific officer for the APDA, and also Gloria back up to talk about, and David, and to talk about a few of these questions that we were looking at. David was, I don't know if you heard that, come on in here. Rebecca and Gloria, come on over here. Did you hear the conversation about, is it executive functioning that, yeah. And can you sort of answer that question? Would you like to know that, David?
Love
to know the answer.
The brain is very complicated. We used to call it hand waving. Like we can try to explain it, but you know, in the end, there's a lot we don't understand. But there is a fundamental problem that's pretty characteristic of a Parkinson's person, where there is this inability to multitask or to do a lot of things at once. And it's called executive dysfunction, and it's something that is relatively unique to Parkinson's, so it's not necessarily found in other brain disorders quite as much. And the reason I like, you know, bringing it to people's attention is because it's treatable. You just have to not do more than one thing at once. You know, you have to break it down. So it could be that, you know, when you were 30, you were able to, you know, plan Thanksgiving dinner and also write a note to your, you know, dog sitter at the same time, but you can't anymore. So you just have to accept that and do, you know, do one thing at a time with full attention. And often that goes a really, really long way. So people get frustrated because it's not what they used to be like, But that's, I think, part of this whole conversation. You're not the way you used to be, and no one is the way they used to be, and that is okay. And I think that's going to be part of our conversation later with our with our Parkinsex kit. You know, you have to meet yourself where you are, and that's very, very okay. But if you can't meet yourself where you are, then it's very frustrating and anxiety ridden, and it breeds its own issues. So, acceptance is.
Huge.
Yeah. It's huge.
Gloria, can you talk about managing expectations? Because in the clip, it was almost like Pedro was asking, is this the way it's going to be, or is there something wrong? And if we have an expectation that, oh, this is what this is, and Rhoda and Sam, you're very good about this, then we know how to deal with that, right? For example, we know that every day, things might be a little different. We have to kind of check in and see what... Can we do this today or not, right? Can Matt play today or not, right? There are going to be days that are good and bad.
Yeah, I think that phrase, managing expectations, is really important, and they need to talk to each other about it, really understanding where the person with PD is that day, because every day is different, every hour is different, but certainly every day is different. So, and I think there has to be an acceptance that some days are going to be really difficult, and on those days, multitasking, if it was hard on one day, it's going to be triple hard on that day. And there needs to be a real understanding of that. So they have to share that with each other. But I think managing expectations means limiting some of the things they do on certain days, reducing some of the load. And I think that the idea of understanding and not criticizing or not blaming the person who has the Parkinson's for some of that executive dysfunction that they really can't help, because while they can learn some techniques, and there are all sorts of techniques. There's ways of, writing notes and putting it in your phone and reminders. There's millions of ways to do it. But the bottom line is there's some things they can't do, and they need to really accept the things that they can't do.
Yeah, and Rhoda, you were saying that too, that there are times when you know what you can do. Did you want to come and just say that? Yeah.
I think that one thing that Sam and I have worked out is that I only ask for help when I need it, and I don't want it if I don't need it. I don't want to be more helpless. And there are certain rules, like Sam knows he can't ask me a question if my alarm has gone off and I'm heading for medication, because I might just not be able to multitask and remember to take my meds.
And you let them know when you can't do certain things.
Yeah, exactly.
You're very clear about what you can do and when you can do and if you need help.
Right, exactly. And it's usually with physical things that I need help with, or that I'm just exhausted at the end of the day and I don't feel up to making dinner.
Right.
Sam will come in and
rescue
just fill
you.
In.
Yeah, awesome. Thank you, Rhoda. I think that's a great strategy, and I love that you said that. Listen, if I haven't had my medication, that's not the time to ask me if I'm about to get my medication. Rebecca, that's a great strategy, right?
Yeah, and I think what Rhoda was saying is that if you get distracted, you may forget to take your medicine. So
And then there's that terrible, did I take the pill? Or did I not take the pill? argument that has to happen.
Right, exactly. David, can we talk about music for a moment? You said earlier that music is an integral part of who you are, and it's your pleasure, and you actually get lost. Is that the right brain when he goes in there and he's like, he can't think of anything else, he's in flow state? What's going on?
I do not have the answer. I wish I knew what was going on in your brain when you did music, because that would be awesome.
And maybe you would get the Nobel Peace Prize, right, if you could figure that out. The brain is really the next frontier, right? There is a lot we don't know, everybody, and that's kind of both exciting and frustrating. Is it one of the reasons that you are a neurologist?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. We have a video of a special friend. You want to cue that up for us?
This is my friend Karen Ziemba, who He's going to sing a song for Merrily We Roll Along. Karen and I did, we've done many shows together. And the World Goes Round off Broadway together. We did Steel Pier on Broadway. We did a beautiful show by John Kander called Kid Victory at the Roundabout together. And she's just an extraordinary performer. And she sang this song, which is so appropriate to this subject.
Awesome. Let's go ahead. We'll sit and watch.
All right. Now you know life is crummy. Well, now you know. I mean, big surprise, people love you and tell you lies. Bricks can fall out of clear blue skies. Put your dimple down, now you know. Okay, there you go. Learn to live with it, now you know. It's called flowers wilt, it's called apples rot, it's called thieves get rich and saints get shot. It's called God don't answer prayers a lot. Okay, now you know. Okay, now you know. Now forget it, don't fall apart at the seams. It's called letting go your illusions, and don't confuse them with dreams. Yes, sir, quite a blow. Don't regret it, and don't let's fall to extremes. It's called what's your choice, it's called count to ten. It's called burn the bridges, start again. You should burn them every now and then, or you'll never grow. Because now you grow, that's the killer, is now you grow. You're right, nothing's fair, and it's all a plot. And tomorrow doesn't look too hot, right? You better look at what you've got over here. Hello! Okay, now you know, right?
Great, and I think it's a perfect way to introduce our next segment with David and Pedro. Can we go ahead and roll that tape?
I hear that you really want to enjoy your relationship and love and have some space and time for that. Amen. And sometimes the last 3 years, it seems like one thing after another, there hasn't been that as much time to do that.
It's changed the definition of our relationship. It's, you know, the caretaking duties increased exponentially over the last 3 years, so that it became much more patient nurse relationship. And I've actually used the words, I want our marriage back. I mean, we've had that conversation, like, how do we bring the romance back into the relationship despite all the physical challenges? It has to be a conscious choice, because otherwise it will just slip away.
And the idea of getting back to normal, which is so elusive and
what is that?
And what is that now? Yeah. I mean, this is that, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But maybe learning to live in the new normal is... Yeah.
It is. There's no going back to the old normal.
Right.
And we can grieve that and then let it go and bless it and then acknowledge what's here today and plan for that.
Well, I just want to say the love that you have for one another is so clear. The love, the devotion, the desire to connect and to appreciate and to be together.
The things that my having Parkinson's have done to the two of us feel overwhelming at times, but because of the Parkinson's, we are closer in a way that we never would have been mm-hmm. without it. We've accomplished things that seemed impossible. He's shown me kindness and sternness and every possible emotion to get me through it. He's risked everything for a relationship I don't thank the world for the Parkinson's, but there are marvelous things that have happened because of it. And I have to be grateful for that.
And we do have a ritual, a gratitude ritual, because, and this will definitely make me emotional, we are sitting in our home in the Catskills where we were married in 2014. And at that wedding, we had all of Broadway's A-list singing to us, because they are obviously close friends of David's and colleagues. Two of Broadway's finest and our closest friends, Maren Mazie and Rebecca Luker, died shortly after our wedding, one from ovarian cancer, the other from ALS. We still have each other. What their husbands wouldn't have given for more years with their spouses, despite whatever challenges they brought. So Parkinson's can send us whatever it wants as long as we can be together.
Oh my God, don't say that.
Well, okay, fine, but... What I want is more years together and all the other things that maybe we could attempt to do in addition to the drug regimen with diet and exercise to sort of make the years that we do have left together the best they can be.
What do you love most about each other?
I love the whole package. Handsome, smart, funny, caustic, talented, and perfect for me.
You know, I do think we complement each other well. David is steadfast. He saved me in so many ways. What we haven't talked about were all my physical challenges. I developed many autoimmune diseases in my late 30s, which leveled me. I was bedridden for 2 years, and David supported me. Put a roof over my house, put food on the table until I was able to work again. And it was very gradual climbing out of a deep, dark hole. David never lost his composure. And, you know, I'm a Cuban hysteric, so I can bounce all over the place. I think in some ways we've saved each other at different times.
Beautiful. I once had a brain mentor, somebody that was teaching me about the brain. She was an educator. And she said that there's three ways that the brain loves. One, the basic brain or reptile brain, is that we walk together. We might not know what to say, but we just hold hands and we walk the path together. Two, we feel, the limbic brain. We let our feelings in. We let our feelings for one another show, and we're impacted by one another. And then three, to mitigate that left brain, we appreciate and we have gratitude for the other person. And you guys have all three. It's been a pleasure to talk with you.
Such a pleasure. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Caroline.
Thank you. It has been a pleasure, and now it is after dark. So we're going to have the after dark conversation. Rebecca, you want to come on up and bring with you your kit? Where is this? We have, how would you describe it? We'll find it. Oh, wait, it's over here. Is this the Parky sex kit? What is it called? Parkin sex kit. Sex kit? I'm sorry, I don't think I pronounced it right. What is it called? Oh, you want me to hold it? Parkin sex.
Yes.
Okay. Oh, Wendy's going to come. Oh. All right. So we're going to pack and unpack this, right? There is Vanna. All right.
Vanna,
yes. Rebecca, in the video we saw that Pedro asked, how do we keep the romance alive, right? And all of our participants tonight have been in or have had loving relationships. With any relationship over time, it requires attention. Some would say work to keep love alive. is this why you guys created this kit? Like,
so
let's talk about this.
Step back to put this in context. A problem, let's say, that has been identified in the Parkinson community is that relationships suffer often. from many of the things that Pedro and David were talking about. And Pedro very articulately said it requires a lot of attention. It's not going to, it'll slip away otherwise. So that is something that you hear a lot. And people don't pay attention, and they aren't as conscious of this problem as David and Pedro are, and it slips away. We see this a lot. And so we wanted, APDA, American Parkinson Disease Association, wanted to create a resource which can make those decisions much more conscious and make it easier for people like Pedro and David to interact with their relationship in a meaningful way. So what this is a book. Starts with a book, which basically highlights some of the challenges that enter a relationship with Parkinson's disease. And it's challenges specifically with intimacy. So challenges with being physical with one another. So Parkinson's is a movement disorder. There are movement problems that can get in the way of intimacy. There are lots of what we call non-motor symptoms of Parkinson's, depression or apathy. Other challenges which may make their way into a relationship and affect how people can be intimate with each other. And so we created this book that basically acknowledges that, you know, that says there are challenges, those challenges are not going away. Another great thing that Pedro was saying was there's a new normal. You know, we're not gonna go back to the way it was, we have to acknowledge that, but with this new normal, let's see what we can do. And so it basically breaks down things that you can do, things that you can actually do to enhance a physical intimate relationship. And I'm avoiding using the word having sex because it may not be that. It may not be that. It may be that. It may be actual intercourse, but it may not be, and that's okay. And so this is a way of giving people ideas about how to interact physically in ways they may not have before. And so included in this book, so each of the chapters corresponds to an item in the kit and explains how you might use this item to enhance physical connection. And so in this kit is a bath bomb, a feather, a blindfold, a scented candle, and I'm missing one thing, oh, and stones. And the book goes through how to use these items and what you could potentially do with these various items to enhance your relationship. And of course, you can do what you wish with them as well. And so we have distributed this this kit to our first group, and we're getting feedback. And we're asking people, which items did you use? Did you find the items helpful? You know, what other items could potentially be useful, et cetera, et cetera, and so forth. And so we are hopefully going to be able to refine based on the feedback. And what I should also mention is that the book has, you know, illustrations, and you know, it was a fine line. We wanted to make sure that people felt comfortable reading the book, that they didn't feel like they were reading pornography, but that it also represented the reality. And we tried to keep the character, the artist tried to keep the characters not specifically male or female, not specifically old or young. We wanted to make sure that the characters were not, you know, all these young, hip, gorgeous people, because lots of people with Parkinson's may not look like that. And so we wanted to make sure people could see themselves in the illustrations. And so that's right. Another piece that we want people to focus on.
Great.
Questions?
Yeah, well, what I would like to do is bring back all of our guests that we've had on and just ask, you know, you guys, what do you do to stay connected? So Rhoda and Sam and Gloria and Harold and Matt and Frank and Doug and David, come on up, right? And let's just have a seat and, you know. Yeah, we can stand. We've got a lot of guests tonight. Did you notice? Thank you. Anybody want to go first? Yes.
Thank you. We dance, we play tennis, we cuddle, and I get up every 2 hours because Parkinson's wants some attention. And when I'm up, I really like being able to just cuddle and until I can fall back asleep.
Beautiful, beautiful. Sam, did you want to add? Just hold your mic up.
What is that?
Did you, you need to hold your mic if you want to add.
Yeah. No, we make certain, I make certain things happen.
All right. All right. Awesome. Anyone else? Yeah, go ahead. Harold, right here. Yeah.
I basically dance at Dancer PD. I love it. And socialize with people there and connecting with people. Try to go as much as possible. I love going to concerts, museums, walks. Mm-hmm. Just try to keep busy.
So you stay connected.
Do things, staying connected,
awesome.
Yeah.
And then is there anything that you want, any of you guys want to talk about intimacy-wise that are helpful for you, that you feel like you could share in this moment? No pressure.
Well, one of the things that Pedro was talking about was the transition from caretaker and patient mm-hmm. back into romantic partner. And that was really hard for us to grapple with for a while. We had to really discuss, you know, continuing physical intimacy, even though it might be more comfortable to not always, I don't know, sit closely on the couch wasn't as comfortable for me as it had been in the past, and try to find other ways to still have physical intimacy in the relationship. I can't wait to use the feather and the stones. I don't know what they're for.
Beautiful. Well, to round out our show tonight, we have two of your students here. Right. No. Anybody else? Did you guys want to? Matt, go ahead.
Just had a quick comment about intimacy. There's different kinds of intimacy. I had intimacy with my partner who was still living. But after he passed on, of course, that didn't exist anymore. And I've been dating. But I found there's other ways to be intimate with people. For instance, at Dancer PD or other places, I'm becoming a serial hugger. Yeah. I love hugging people just and feeling close to people that way.
Beautiful.
That's another kind of intimacy, I think.
And I also think, Matt, you were talking earlier, I don't want to put you on the spot, but you just find different ways, right? In a way, innovative ways, workarounds. You mentioned that, yeah.
Yeah, when I'm excited about anything, a piece of music, a fight scene on a TV, other things, my tremor kicks up. So that's just part of our life now. It's also a barometer, so Frank knows if it's working.
That's awesome. Gloria, did you want to say anything?
Well, I just think that, I think what you said was important, was that intimacy isn't always sex, and we're talking about, again, we're talking about connection, and not forgetting, no matter how hard it is, but to maintain that connection, no matter what. And you have to work at it. I think that's the piece of it, too. It's really, I think, when things are tough, again, people tend to walk away or move away from each other. And I think, you know, David and Pedro showed it so beautifully on screen that they've had to work at that reconnection. And so I think the idea of working to stay connected is really important.
Thank you. And thank you all, everyone.
Is that a little story? Just a little story about connectivity. Something happened to me. I was coming home from a concert at Met Opera, and happened to be the Ukraine concert. But on the way home, I was standing in the subway platform, and the three guys, like about 30 feet away from me, and they were like dancing with each other and doing moves, and they had no music, just dancing with each other. And I picked up one of the moves, and I threw it to them, they threw it back to me, and we just exchanged these dance moves back and forth on the subway platform. And I thought it really amazing to make connectivity like that, which something Dancer PD has kind of opened up for me. I feel like very comfortable dancing in public.
That's awesome.
As crazy as my saying.
Right, and that's what intimacy gives us. Into me, I see, right? So it's a connection, not only to myself, but that part of that sensual part of myself, that creative part of myself, but also the ability to share that with another. And tonight, we are going to round out our show with a special performance. Do you want to talk a little bit about these
I've
two
been
wonderful
so lucky
people?
In my life.
Thank you, everyone.
I spent 34 years conducting Broadway shows, and then I couldn't anymore, and I became a teacher at Manhattan School of Music, and it's been just as exciting and creative a career for me. I love it just as much. I can't believe that I found something else that I am so fulfilled by. But tonight I brought two of my sophomore students from Manhattan School of Music to sing a song about relationships. And in the classroom you can cast your musical however you want to without regard to gender or ethnicity or anything. So we can explore many different worlds in the classroom. Here are Yo-Yo, Zhu, and Xavier Cornell in a little song from Fiddler on the Roof.
I like him. He's a little crazy, but I like him. And what's more important, Huddle likes him. Huddle loves him. So what can we do? It's a new world. A new world. Love. Golda. Do you love me?
Do I? What?
Do you love me?
Do I love you? Without daughters getting married and this trouble in the town, you're upset, you're worn out. Go inside, go lie down. Maybe it's indigestion.
Golda, I'm asking you a question. Do you love me?
You're a fool!
I know, but do you love me?
Do I love you? For 25 years I've washed your clothes, cooked your meals, cleaned your house, given your children, milked the cow. After 25 years, why talk about love right now?
Golda, the first time I met you was on our wedding day. I was scared.
I was shy.
I was nervous.
So was I.
But my father and my mother said we'd learn to love each other. And now I'm asking, Golda, do you love me?
I'm your wife!
I know! But do you love me?
Do I love him? For 25 years I lived with him, fought with him, starved with him. 25 years my bed is his. If that's not love, what is?
Then you love me.
I suppose I do.
And I suppose I love you too.
It doesn't change a thing. But even so, after 25 years, it's nice to know.
I can think of no better way to end our show. Thank you, thank you, thank you, everybody, for joining us tonight. A special thanks to the Parkinson's Foundation for this community grant, and to all of you and all of our guests. I'm going to list them one more time. It's just been an incredible conversation. The Broadway Best series for Parkinson's has been an amazing journey. I thank, from the bottom of my heart, David Loud.
Well, thank you.
For David Leventhal, of course, Gloria Lebeaux, Rebecca Gilbert, Pedro Perot, Rhoda Cahan, Matt Castle, Frank Galgano, Doug Shapiro, Harold Clinton, Richard X. Bennett. Yo-Yo Zhu and Xavier Cornell. And David will be selling some copies of his book in the back. And also, we have a CD from Parker Plays X. And for those of you on Zoom, if you're still there, and I hope you are, we've posted details on how to obtain a copy of David's book and Richard's CD. We have handouts, and we have posted in the chat links to everything that we've talked about. So please be sure to check those out. And once again, what a very, very special evening it has been. Broadway Best for Parkinson is supported, again, by the Parkinson's Foundation. We thank them wholeheartedly for giving us this opportunity for 2 years to create and provide this unique series. Our previous episodes are live on the JCC's YouTube channel. You can check them out, and you can watch them at any time. We have a very short survey, which of course we need you guys to do. We'll send, for those of you here, we'll send that to you via a link. Please fill that out. That really is an important part of our grant, and we really appreciate it. Your feedback is everything to us, truly. A special thank you to the place where I work, the Marlene Meyerson JCC Manhattan, and it is an incredible organization. Northwell Health, to our production manager, scriptwriter, bench carrier, Whitney Chapman, and our AV team, Sam's, yes, I know, Whitney is amazing, Sam Brunswick, Mike Taylor, Matt Temkin, Jeff Fontaine, and our marketing team, Shara Kaiserman, Amanda Schechter, and Nicole Denzel, and our in-person hostess, Jennifer Terrell, and Joanne. But for most of you, and for all of you, thank you for coming. Thank you. Good night, everyone. Take care.